Thank you, Kat. You're so wonderful. I love you, girl. Minister Kat. Hey.
Hey,
that's Kat. That's my hey. Minister Kat, thank you. Our tools in the studio wasn't set, so we're just having all kind of challenges, but the devil is a lie. The devil is a lie today. he a lie. Okay, can y'all hear? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? I'm anticipating that you can. We've set the levels, and let's give some shout outs. Trina, that's our reliable. Thank you.
Thanks for tuning in, Trina.
Charles, Randy, Minister Kat. Gotta love you. Ma. Hey, Ma. Patrick. Chardonnay. Hi. Daryl, Eric, Joshua, Dennis. We are just so happy that you guys keep coming back every week. We thank you for being family members. You know, because you know with family, you know, you can say stuff to family that you can't say to other people. You know, you can't get away with other people. So, you know, so we are elated that you are part of our family so that you won't get in offense when we tell you the truth. That truth hurts sometimes. Mm-hmm. It hurts. But, you know, we do it in love. We do it in love because, again, we want to, we are about the betterment of our people. Our culture, humankind, okay? The human race, we just want people to be better. Mind, body, and soul, okay? And so with that being said, I'll go ahead and give you my disclaimer. I'm L.A. Parker. I am a psych student, PhD, ABD as of last week. I am
all ABD. Right. Hey.
Sorry, I'm about to get happy. Woo! Y'all don't understand. I won't testify today, but yes. Finally, ABD.
Finally.
Yeah,
she's
you know,
been working
I had
hard
a scare,
on this.
You know, earlier, a couple months ago, I was supposed to be ABD and I failed a class. You know, and finally, all of the coursework is out of the way, and I'm going to be using you guys to get data. For this dissertation, and I'm going to publish it to be a book, so you guys have to check that out. And we'll be talking about all the stuff that we talk about on Couch Time. Mm-hmm. And I'll be including all of our guests and all of the things that we go through within Couch Time this last year will be parts of the book. So y'all be chapter 32. Yes. Y'all won't be that spicy chapter. Y'all won't be 29. Y'all have to just fold the page and go on to 32. Y'all be there. Yes, so I'm just elated with that, and so let's what we got today. Well, we were talking about the hot topics. Chicken
pies against Chick-fil-A.
I'm a loyal. I'm loyal. If you my friend, I'm loyal. If I eat you, I'm loyal. So I understand what y'all saying.
Not eat you, but
if I
the food.
If yeah. I oh Lord, please, what nobody eat. If I entertain your eating establishment, I have to break it down for T
that's
over here.
That's why Karen was laughing Tanya, so hard. That's why I'm like,
Sean, Sean, Trina, come and get her. Come and get her. Look. But I'm loyal in every aspect of my life. And so, with that being said, Chick-fil-A,
I got you. That's because she hadn't tried.
No. You know what? And I ain't even sure I want to try it now. I am loyal. I love, even my baby said today, Mom, if I had to only eat at one place for the rest of my life. Uh-uh. Yes, he did at 16.
Chick-fil-A is the one place.
Yes. He said, Mama, I love their breakfast. And I love they sandwiches. Yes. So, we got you, Chick-fil-A. You might have to make a Chick-fil-A commercial. Have you seen that Chick-fil-A commercial where everybody was singing a cappella? Mm-hmm. So, I don't know what y'all talking about with that Popeyes. All that prefabricated.
I'm not a Popeyes fan. But that sandwich, wait till you taste it.
And you know that Popeyes is different everywhere you go.
Oh, is it?
Yes, when I go home to Louisiana, Popeyes down there, It's different.
It's better.
Yes. It's like, but you know, because you know, and this is why I don't do Papados. So all you Papados lovers, don't be hating on me, okay? We family, love me, okay? So Papados, I don't really just favor Papados. I'll eat them, but I'm like, out of all of the restaurants in the world, out of all of the talented chefs that are in these back hole, you know, You go to Papados where they have bag one, bag two, and bag three. And they put bag one and bag two together and mix it up, and then there you go. It's prefabricated. They come pre-made, and they just
mix it up.
But why wouldn't I want something that's authentic, you know, and original? Somebody who spent time and went to Spain or Europe or Yugoslavia somewhere to get the training to, you know, to put, you know, have you ever ate something?
Put in the work.
You know what I'm saying? If you have tasted something, you like, wow, you don't know how they came up with this flavor to get this. Right. And it's just like, wow, you know? And so I think that we rob ourselves by, you know, just consistently going to the same franchise facilities. Not saying that you shouldn't go to the Papa Do's, but I'm saying try something different. Mm-hmm. Try something, those little back hole, you know, mom and pop shops. They mean.
Thibodeau's.
Thibodeau's? Oh, yeah. That's my Papa Do's, right? Thibodeau's, okay. They from Louisiana. Yes. And so, but yeah, so that's you know, the word on the street is the Papa Do's chicken. Mm-hmm. But no, you know, but I love good food. Everybody know I love good food and I love ice cream. So I'll never leave Texas because Bluebell is here. And I you know, food, I love good food. So I'll give it to it. If they got okay. It, you know, I'll give it to them. You know, I'll take T's advice. If she say right. They're good, they
just
good.
Taste it.
Yeah, she say
I like Chick-fil-A, don't get me wrong, but Popeye's got it going on too.
Yeah. Okay, did we go over the representative heuristic last time? Did we do that?
No.
Okay, so this representativeness heuristic, it describes original. It was originally described by Amos and Daniel in the 70s. This theory employs a strategy. I did
learn how to talk while I was gone.
She knew how to talk.
This is a theory that employs a strategy of making judgments based solely on something that already exists in the mind rather than weighing out all the facts. And I think that we all do this from time to time. Is, you know, we make decisions based on what we previously experienced.
Right.
We make decisions based on maybe something that someone else told us.
Right.
Rather than gathering facts, making decision on facts.
That's right.
And this is actually a theory. So when you do this, kind of check yourself and say, you know, am I gathering the facts to make
an intellectual decision,
or am I just making a decision based on what I already know? Mm-hmm. So these strategies often wrong. Right, but they are often used because they are much faster than delving through information that, you know, trying to find the facts, trying to find what, you know.
Well,
so it's
well, she
easy
said
access.
It was good.
Yeah.
So let's go with
yeah,
that.
You yeah. See that? You
yeah.
See that?
Yeah.
So I'm not going based on what I already know about Popeyes.
And it goes back to chicken.
I'm going on the facts. I'm gonna go on the facts. So how about that? So that's representative heuristic. And so be mindful, you guys. You know, we try to give you psychological topics and tips so that it can increase your vocabulary and you can have a broader understanding of psychology. So that's your tip for today. Okay. We got some good stuff. We're gonna go into the healing. We got straight from the couch, but before we get into we have to, and it's my broken language, my Ebonics, we gotta, okay? I'm gonna stop that,
because
you know, when you're at home with your teenagers, you have to really get out of mommy kid mode and get into adult mode. And sometimes it's difficult, yeah. but it you know, hard. we have to be articulate, okay?
Yes.
For our vast variety and different facets of audience that we have. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, what we are about to do is introduce to you author Karen Metcalf.
All right, Karen. We're so happy to have you here.
I'm going to be blessed. So, y'all don't understand so my much. Emotions right now.
Y'all got to hear but this yes, story. Yes.
We are about to. yes, she's about to. Miss Karen.
Yes, ma'am.
This book,
yes, ma'am.
Missing Person.
Yes.
You know, okay, before we just dive into the book, tell us something about the author. What?
Tell us about you.
Arthur? Yes. You know, give us the scoop. So, give us the 411.
So, Karen is, I'm a mother, and I am the 10th child of 13 children.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes.
Love, much love in the family.
Yes. And I worked for executive offices in corporate for years, and now I'm an entrepreneur, and
oh my,
I love it.
That is so awesome, and
yes,
it's a testament
yes.
for you. It's a testament for you.
If God says go, go. Yes,
oh
it was a big jump, but oh my gosh, it's been wonderful.
So you're an entrepreneur,
yes,
and you're an author,
yes,
and so how long? What is your what's your service line for the business?
So for the business, Karen's Key Concepts is just what I use to give consulting services. But I was focused on trying to build a business. But meantime, I was suffering from panic attacks, mm-hmm, and they were more extensive and more frequent. And so one day, I had a really bad panic attack. I was at home alone, and I went through the Rolodex in my head and said, "Who can I call?" And everybody that I thought to call was people were taking their kids back to school. So I'm just going through this anxiety or the palpitations, and I heard the Lord say, "You need to tell your story." Well, I'm like, "Oh, okay." I mean, if you've had a panic attack, you'll do whatever. So I said, "Okay, I'll tell my story." Didn't have a clue as how I was going to do that. So I started doing Facebook, and I'll say something, take it down, because I was still embarrassed. I was still ashamed. I was still panicking, and I was still depressed. But I said, I know that I heard God say, tell your story, mm-hmm, because here I am. My children had left the home. I'm alone. Fortunately, I have hope because I have Jesus Christ. But what about that person that doesn't have hope?
Yes, indeed.
And so the Lord was telling me to tell my story. So lo and behold, you know, you still want to listen, but kind of not. So I went to a life coach and, you know, kind of make a career change. And she says, you need to write a book and tell your story. I said, you know. I was like, there you go. No confirmation.
Yes.
And that's what started the journey. Some people ask me, how long did it take to write the book? I say 2 decades, because I had to live it.
Exactly.
But once I started writing, I actually started healing.
Mm-hmm.
There was
mm-hmm.
some healing. And going back and reading it.
So it was actually like therapy to you.
Very much so. And I encourage, if nothing else, if you don't want to write a book, write a note. I encourage you to just journal, write down things.
And do you think that the writing process pull more out of you? Because I find that when you're writing, I needed therapy through my writing.
Yes.
Because when you're writing, you are reliving
yes.
those different components. So chapter one, when I'm doing chapter one, I need a whole lot of tissue. I need some bluebell, butter pecan, not vanilla, because vanilla
yes.
ain't gonna get it during
yes.
chapter one.
Yes. Yes.
You know, so do you think that it actually pulls more from you? And what was your support systems through that process?
Well, definitely pull more from me. And because I realized I started writing maybe 7-8 months ago, and just writing down little notes of things. But once I really got into it, I did. I had to step back because the tears were flowing.
Yes.
I was starting to identify feelings that I didn't know I had,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Discovering things that I didn't know that I was holding inside. I started putting names to things that I was still ashamed to put the name to an association. So, but my support system was amazing. When I tell you, the reason what actually kept making me write was the tug of my heart from people wanting to hear that they were not alone, and that you have, you're not crazy, you have the courage to talk about a taboo subject that everybody's dealing with, but it's they don't want to talk about it. Mm-hmm. Some cases, honestly, they don't know how to articulate what they're experiencing. It's hard to trust. It's just a lot of things, and I just felt that I had to tell the story because I didn't want, you know, panic attacks is what I experienced, and non-suicidal depression. And it was extremely important for me to let people know that everybody that's depressed is not suicidal.
Yes, say that.
Those are some things.
We talk about depression here on the show all the time.
There's a lot of misconceptions.
But there are so many different levels of depression and different types of depression. Mm-hmm. And but people, when you say you're depressed, people start to look at you like,
oh, yes, exactly.
Where's the Valium?
They think you're a Debbie Downer or something like that. And they don't understand that it's not that's why I said panic attacks, they're not what you think, because it's not what people think. Even with the anxiety and the anxiousness, I want to clarify misconceptions on that, you know,
because, you know, if people really, you know, like getting into your book and understand that we all have been depressed at one period of time. You might not
know it.
Know it, you know, or categorize it as such, but every single person on the face of this earth has dealt with a level of depression. It might not be manic depressive, or it might not, you know, it might not be one of the larger ones, but we all have dealt with depression.
Yes.
If you have dealt with loss, you've dealt with depression.
Yes.
If you dealt with disappointment, you've dealt with depression. Yes. So it's good that you are able to articulate, put it in literature where people can go and get that information. Mm-hmm. So, you know, again, we want to be informed. So, you know, the panic attacks prompted the move to become an author and tell your story.
Yes.
And you had a good support system.
Yes.
But who exactly is the story talking to?
So, well, let me make sure I say this. I'm not a licensed professional. I just lived the life.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And I am, you know, I like to study and, you know, but the audience would be anybody that have suddenly, their heart suddenly start to race for no reason at all. And you didn't know why, whether you were driving, sitting still.
She ain't talking about because you saw him with no shirt on. Yeah, okay, talking about palpitations.
That kind of panic.
Yeah, we ain't talking about that.
The key thing is you don't know why, okay?
Yeah, okay, we have to clarify because we know some of y'all special.
We've all been anxious before, but we may have known why we were anxious.
Yes.
But a panic attack is a sudden onset of fear. And most of when people have a panic attack, they think they're going to die or something horrible's going to happen. So the audience I'm talking to, that's first and foremost, is the people that suffer from panic attacks. You're not alone. Mm-hmm. Please seek some type of help. Find a professional. If whoever you tried before didn't work, try somebody else, just like you would with your hair. You would just keep trying.
Keep trying until you get it right.
If you take medication, again, please keep taking it. Let your doctor tell you when to come off and how to come off. Please follow the instructions of the doctor.
Be consistent.
Yes. Those are key things. But in addition to that, I would like to talk to people, because society teaches us what to do if someone has a heart attack or stroke. But if you have a panic attack, you know, I want to teach people what you can do to help somebody. And please, what not to say.
Yes.
Get over it. Worry too much. Overthink.
But, you know,
things,
panic,
you know,
attacks is one of those topics or one of those issues that you don't hear about much. We do hear about depression. We hear about anxiety. We hear about all types of psychosis.
Yeah.
But you don't hear about panic attacks.
Yeah.
And I even had a cousin-in-law who had panic attacks when they were around a lot of people.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, there's different triggers. That's
there's
the other thing.
Triggers.
Those are different triggers.
And,
yes.
And you know, this would have been good, you know, so that maybe literature can be a support system.
Yes.
Literature can be a support system.
Because that with your cousin had, sometimes people that experience that, I don't want to go certain places because if
it's going to be a lot of people.
Well,
yes.
Or if that situation triggers a panic attack, then I don't know if anybody's going to know how to handle
what
me.
To do.
So now I'm embarrassed or ashamed for what I'm experiencing because I can't explain it and people don't know.
Do we know what to do? Do we really know what to do in the case that someone, a loved one, or we are in an environment where someone have a panic attack? That may be something that we need to check into to get some information on. So how do you handle?
So I do have a good support system. My my children were very supportive. I'm very transparent with them. Once they got old enough and mature enough to understand, I would say, hey, you guys, watching bad things on TV or negative stuff, you know, bad, whatever my triggers were, I educated them about it, and they did whatever they could to help me avoid it. And so when I had a panic attack, they knew things to do, turn off the, you know, lights, whether it was getting me some cold water or, again, different people did have different triggers. And
so that you would handle it different.
To handle it different.
Okay.
That's why I say it's, but that's why I saw it, it's so important that we talk about it so people can know what they're experiencing can be treated and they'll get the proper help. Then they'll know once they're diagnosed, they'll know what they need to do, how to have it treated. I know what my triggers are, but somebody else's triggers may be something
maybe
else.
Different.
And the other thing too, which was some people have panic attacks maybe once, but some people have panic disorder. And they may have it more often. So there's a lot more to it. And in my book, what I do, Missing Persons, I'm very transparent about my personal experience because I know that other people have experienced some of those things. But I also share resources for either the person that's suffering or their loved ones.
The caregiver.
So to help them go to one place to be able to find help and know where to go.
Yeah, so. People have a tendency to be fearful of what they are or not, what they don't understand and they don't have knowledge about.
Yes.
And so instead of becoming a support system, they actually run the other way.
Yes, I've had some of that
period.
Too. I've had some of that too. And I understand it. I'm okay with it. And let me tell you why. Because when you sometimes having a panic attack, one of the scariest things is that you're going to have another one. And so if I suffer from panic attacks and somebody else does, whether I know they do or not, and they may not want to be around because they don't know if I may say something that could trigger one. So, you know, it's just one of those things until you get more the education about it. So some people, they think it's a Debbie Downer thing. Mm-hmm. You know, every day of my life is not a day of doom and gloom. So for some people, it may be. But every day, you know, that 21 days Mental Health Awareness Month, is, you know, nobody's talking about it anymore, 21 days of news, somebody is committing suicide. Somebody's depressed
right now.
Please don't make a permanent decision over a short-term situation. You know, I believe if we talk more about it, you know, let people know, hey, if heart health, you go to a cardiologist.
Yes.
Mental health, you go to a psychiatrist.
Yes, yes.
You know, just talk about it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If you guys have any questions for Ms. Metcalf, 214-431-5032. Again, that's 214-431-5032. Call in. Ask her questions about the book. Ask her questions about panic attacks. And what, you know, one thing, I think that is one thing about the caregivers.
Yes.
But if you are experiencing panic attacks, don't be afraid to talk about it, to share. And because a person can't help you if they don't know that you are experiencing. Now, I said call 214-431-5032. I did not say
call my cell phone. Pay attention, people.
Look. We're not talking about that kind of mental illness today. 404-431-5032. Yes. Bridge a comment in the comments section here, and we'll ask the question for Metcalf to answer for us. Again, call us. Call in. So while we have our guest here, we can get some good information. Again, yes, this book, you guys, you have to get it. Missing Person. Mm-hmm. Missing Person. Let me say the, yes.
Coming soon.
Yeah, Missing yeah. Person, you guys. I want you to check this book out.
BucciPublishing.com and Bucci, anywhere Bucci Publishing.
BucciPublishing.com. You can also go to www.couchtime.com and yes. we will have information how you can get in touch with Miss Metcalf, as well as purchase her book on there. Also, we will have her on our Facebook page, our Instagram page, and you will have the recording of this show on YouTube as well. So check the book out, Missing Persons. If you are experiencing any level of mental health, having any challenges, if you're not sure, if you are questioning,
yes.
if you question, then talk to someone. And, you know, if you don't have anyone to talk to, you can always reach out to us on Couch Time.
Yes.
And we will share with you our resources. We will set you an appointment if you need life coach. We have life coaching staff that we can hook you up with as well. And so, but today we are focusing on panic attacks, and we are looking at different resources we could that will help us in those challenges. So the book, Missing Person. What else can we look forward to from Arthur Metcalf?
Well, now that I've been saying the things I couldn't say out loud, I'll probably tell some other stuff too. You know, I'm really blessed. I get a lot of compliments on my child rearing skills, and I'll probably be sharing some things like that. I have two amazing children, and I want to, you know, share what some of the things I did wrong, but turned out right.
All right,
so,
now.
That, so things like that's coming down the pipes.
Cool. We're excited.
Reconnect relationships,
looking forward
to family,
looking,
children, and
totally
parents.
Looking forward to, because you know what?
Yes.
I always say, I thought that parenting stops at 18.
No.
You know, when you're 18, mm-hmm. you gotta go.
No,
no.
And I have learned now, since, you know what, my kids are 31, 28, and 28, mm-hmm. and 16. And now I realize that at 18, it don't stop.
Mm-hmm. No.
It's just every decade is a different season of parenting.
Yes.
So, and, you know, from 0 to 10, you're doing one thing through parenting, mm-hmm. from 10 to 20, and then so on and so on. And now I'm finding myself being more of a parent
advisor, huh?
Well, coaching. Yay. Yeah, you start at a point, you start coaching them.
It's like, what do you think about this?
Don't buy that car.
Yeah.
Look.
What do you think about this interest rate? What do you think about this credit card?
Let him go, girl. Let him go. He ain't good for you. Is he trying to marry you? What her mama do? You got to teach your children to ask the right questions, because you want to help them avoid some of the toxicity that we experienced growing up. So I realized that parenting doesn't stop. So any assistance I can get, you know, I know people who are in their 40s and at home. So, yeah, we can never stop parenting our children.
Right. Hmm.
Okay, so we behind the ball, behind the A ball on this one. So we're going to go ahead and jump. Okay, so we have been talking about the
family breakdown. The family.
Okay, yes. You know what? Before we go through the family breakdown, we're going to talk about, let's talk about family. We got a letter from one of our family members on Straight From The Couch. And so, you know, it is our duty to put our family on the couch so we can help them, right? Mm-hmm. We got to help them. So, we got a letter from Miss Haley. Miss Haley states that in 2002, she says, at the age of 30, I married my now husband, Doug, and suddenly had an instant family. Not only was I a new wife, but I also now a stepmother to Doug's two small children from a previous marriage. And she mentioned the kid's name. The role of stepmom was foreign to me since none of my close friends or family had been through a divorce. I really didn't have any interaction with people who were divorced or came from divorced families. Shortly after getting married, Doug and I had two more children. And we're proud parents of a blended family of six now, with four children ranging from 13 to 23. While I love being a parent to all four kids, there are a few things I wish I'd known before becoming a step parent. What advice would you give people who are considering marrying a person with children?
Say, get ready for a ride.
Okay, so, you know, there are things that you do need to consider, not just when you are anticipating marrying someone with children, but there's some things that you need to consider when you are contemplating dating someone with children. So we cannot wake up one day and say, you know, you can't help who you fall in love with. There are some decisions that have to be made along the way. So you need to decide before you actually start dating, am I willing to date someone with children? And what does that entail? There is a level of selflessness that comes with dating someone with children. Patience. And compromise.
You have to be unselfish.
And very patient and be willing to compromise. Now, these things here, you would think that they are automatic. These are things that comes with relationships anyway. Being patient, selfless, and compromising, they are components of being married. However, when you are in a blended family, take those things and put them on steroids. It's easy to compromise what we're going to eat for dinner when it's just you and him. But when you have to consider this child have allergies.
All
right. When you have to consider what if you both work, who gets home first, who's going to pick up the kids, all of the elements that not just relationships bring. But being a mom before, being a stepmom before being a mom. So the maternal instincts that you get with becoming a mother hadn't even kicked in yet. Because Miss Haley was not yet a parent, a mother yet. So she was learning on someone else's children. She was learning how to be selfless and I don't care if you want the Popeyes sandwich. I won't.
We're back to the chicken.
I want
McDonald's.
You know, yeah. and so you have to learn how to be selfless, compromise, because people say, you know, we do know that communication, fidelity, finances are the three biggest components of the breakdown of a relationship. However, when you're talking about blended families, the children are one of the biggest components of the breakdown of a family. Because especially when it's a blended family, when people have not adopted the fact that these are now our children.
Yeah.
You have people going in saying that they got a daddy, they don't need a daddy. They got a mama, I don't need a mama. We know that. That is without thought.
Right.
But it is the concept of being a unified, being a unit, having a unified front. That is what you have to have going into it so that no one, children or anyone else, can have any perception that this could be, that there could be a divide.
Right.
So understanding that when we make a decision, we're making a decision
together.
And so these are my children just as equal. I am making decisions. I'm doing things with the mindset the same mindset that he would have. Mm-hmm. So these are our children. And so I think that a lot of people go into relationships for themselves. They go into relationships based on what I can get, how he makes me feel, how she makes me feel, what she contributes, what he contributes to me. And I say that because there's so many people on the couch that say, I don't love him anymore. Mm. He doesn't make me feel the way he used to. Mm. He doesn't do the things that he used to do.
It's because he's tired.
No, because
I'm telling you, you get older.
What is the key word there? Me.
Yep.
Me. Mm. What he's doing for me. Did she say what I'm contributing to him. Mm-hmm. It was all about
how he made me feel.
Mm-hmm. And once he no longer made her feel a certain way, his usefulness was done. And so we have to wonder, why are we getting into relationships? Is it for what we can benefit from it independently, or is it what we can benefit from it? And when you look at it like that, you also say the children. What do the children benefit from it? Because the children are a part of the unit. Now, what does the children benefit from it? This was very important that Haley, that you understand the position of a step parent, because it does not negate his position as the father and what his responsibility is to, because I find a lot of people when they get married for that assistance. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm married now, I can get my kids more. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm married now. Mm-hmm. Now, you know, so no, it does not negate his responsibility. So that's one element of it. But what is the most important with being a step family is that the kids need to see what family looks like. They need to see what love looks like through you. Mm-hmm. That's what they need to see.
A partnership and sacrifice.
They have to see that. Mm-hmm. Our kids, our families no longer know what love looked like. Mm. They don't know what family is supposed to look like. So it is our task. So what is the purpose of our relationships, of our marriages? What is our purpose? If a marriage does not have a purpose, it is in vain. Mm-hmm. We do not get married just for our own gain. We don't get married. We don't get in relationships, whether you understand that or not. We do not get in relationship for us independently to benefit. We get into relationships so that we collectively can benefit the greater good. We can collectively do what God has for us to do. Collectively. If one person can climb a hill, then two people can climb a mountain. Mm-hmm. It's collectively what we can do. So collectively, you can show these children how a relationship is supposed to work. You can show them how they are supposed to court, how they're mm-hmm. supposed to choose their mate, how they're supposed to handle their finances. That is your purpose. And if you're not doing that in your relationship, if you're not, then you are doing a disjustice to the children and to the relationship overall. Not just you're looking at him. The world is looking at you all, and you're a statistic on one side of the fence or the other. So that's my take. I don't know, Karen, if you have anything for them, if you want to give her a nugget.
I think that's great. That, you know, the foundation being love, and the sacrifice, and the thing you said is more of we and us, and not a me and you. So I think that's great.
So some of the things that they can consider. They can consider you, if you are considering getting involved with someone who has children, if you're male or female, you can look at, these are the realities. We're going to give you the hard, okay? The relationship might get harder as the kids age, change. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. But you know what? Two things to remember: expectations and communication.
Yes, with your mate and the children.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep. Set. Yeah. Expectations.
Boundaries.
And yes.
If we and can't say anything else,
this is us.
Boundaries.
And this is you. Yeah.
This is what will happen, and this is what won't happen in here.
Yeah.
What is another tip that we can give them?
Let's see. You might feel alone at times.
Because you will have to share.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And especially if you are a male or female who is accustomed to having all of the time of your mate. You know, mm-hmm. we love to have all of that cuddle time. And now.
Now you got a baby, but jumping now, in the middle saying, hey.
And you like, why are you kind of blocking? You know what I'm saying?
I'm trying to be loving,
loving. You know what yeah, you're like, go on, little old turd. You know, you be. You know what Yes, because, you know, if you are accustomed, hey, you know, there's a concert, you know, like Tony was here this past weekend. Mm-hmm. There's a concert this weekend, and he says, well, I have a daughter-daddy dance to go to. And you're feeling a certain kind of way because you're not accustomed to having to share. So it could be a little lonely because you are transitioning. And anytime that you're transitioning, anytime there's change, there is going to be uncomfortability. And so we have to learn how to deal with uncomfortability, knowing that this too will pass.
Yes.
Okay. So the loneliness will pass.
Yes.
Sometimes the biological parent will always be a part of my family.
Ooh, we need a whole nother couch time for this one. We need a complete nother couch time. Can you repeat that? Talk loud into. I'm talking to you, okay? Mm-hmm. Kim, Jackie, Quita, yes. And you know what? Not just you, Doug, Junior, you too. Say it again, T.
The biological parent will always be a part of my family.
Now, this is a hard blow, but I'm going to tell you straight from the couch, and this is in love. The biological parent will always be a part of your family. Mm-hmm. This is the family. And these people, we all play a part of this family. Uh-huh. And in any family, you got dysfunctional family members. Mm-hmm. You got people who are productive parts of the family that contribute.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You have toxic people who just want to break the family down. Yes. Y'all seen
always
Soul
have
Food?
Something to say.
Y'all seen Soul Food? You got somebody who always trying to get at.
Hurting people hurt people.
Right? So this, but they are always apart because if you do not grasp this concept, you listen, all of you potential step parents, if you do not grasp this component, you will cause yourself a lot of pain because those children will never really accept you. He won't, I'm not going to say he will have issues because you will not, a man or a woman is going to always have empathy for their children. Mm-hmm. And when my children are in pain, I'm in pain as well. Mm-hmm. And if my children are in pain because mom and stepmom are
bumping heads constantly.
Yeah, they could feel that.
Okay, so I'm going to give this scenario and leave it on this because we might need to take this up next time.
Yeah, time flew by today.
On the talking about the step parent. On the most important day of the child's life, they're graduating. Mm-hmm. Okay, they're graduating. They're so excited. I'm going out to school and
I'm getting away from my dad.
Right, I didn't want to say it, but that's what they said. Okay, on the most important day, they walk across the stage. And on the left, they have mom and her family. On the right, they got dad and his family. They look over here and they look over here. They don't know which one to go to.
Mm.
They go to mom family, dad family gonna have an attitude. They go to dad family, where mom's saying, well, I had you some roses and stuff and you didn't even come over here. And it's all about us and our feelings, No one is taking in consideration the child because it's about us and our feeling.
Right.
Why not on that one day? Can we all just sit together for one day? It's not about you.
Yeah, communicate.
The point is not about you. It is about the child. And we are one big happy family, whether we're happy or not. We're one family. And we have to do what's in the best interest, because when that child does not become a productive part of society, everybody looking at the other person, well, you know, you didn't spend enough time with him, or well, you wasn't a good mama, well, you didn't take him to the basketball game. Everybody's pointing, but are we really doing what we're supposed to do? So we need to take that in consideration. When it comes down to being a step-parent, if you can't compromise, if you can't be selfless, what was the other component? Compromise, selfless,
the sacrifice.
If you can't do these things, you need to consider, you just might need to meet someone who hasn't had children yet, or who has grown children, which that's a whole nother beast. It's a whole other beast.
Like you said, but every season there's a different season.
Yes. You need to consider these things, you know, because these are people's lives. And if you are not willing to compromise, to sacrifice, then you are not just hurting your mate. You can be hurting a child as well. So, you know what? After that, I need prayer.
That took a lot out of you, huh?
I need prayer. I mean, because, you know, my sister. And I have some brothers out there too. But we have challenges with embracing the children and who's connected to the children. There's some men who have those challenges too. But when we're talking about being whole as a family, when we talk about healing, we're talking about the family breakdown here. This is a series we're talking about. The series is the family breakdown. When we're talking about these things, we have to address these issues that we are dealing with as a family, the couch time family. Yes. You know that you got challenges. You know you be praying for somebody to hit her in a. You know, I mean, come on, let's be real.
Maybe we need to talk about love and unforgiveness too.
We got these challenges that we need to. Somebody needs to pray. Somebody needs to be fasting in prayer. I'm gonna have Pastor Baston in October. He was a former pastor of Friendship Web, youth pastor of Friendship West, and he gonna come maybe teach us how to pray or something over these issues, because you know you want to put something, you want to offer her a drink and have something in it. That ain't right. That ain't the stepmama way or the stepdaddy way. Okay, Zechariah 2:11 says, many nations will be joined with the Lord in that day and will become my people. I will live among you, and you will know that the Lord Almighty has sent me to you. All right. Amen. We love you. We thank you for tuning in.
Thank you so much for
thanks
having
for coming.
We thank
Darius.
You. It was a joy for you to sit on the couch with. Sometimes it can be a little intense. Because we sometimes have intense topics.
I love transparency.
Yes, but it's really therapeutic, and it's necessary.
Yes.
It's really necessary. So with that being said, we want to go ahead and close today. Love, peace, and soul.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Next week, same time, same day on the couch on the Fishbowl Radio Network.
I'll give you the sun, the rain, the moon, the stars and the mountains.